Good day, class. We are welcome again to Physics Medicine class. Today we'll be considering our topic under measurement of heat energy still, but today we'll be looking at latent heat. As a way of definition, latent heat can actually be defined as that heat that is supplied to or removed from a substance which causes a change of state without a change in temperature. Key thing to note about it is that anytime we talk about latent heat, it brings about change of state without any change in temperature. In other words, we can actually see this heat as hidden heat, even though it is in place, but the temperature is not affected. Take note of that. Now, we have basically two types of latent heat, and they are latent heat of fusion and latent heat of vaporization. Let's quickly pick latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of fusion can actually be defined as that quantity of heat that is required to change the state of a substance. Don't forget, we are dealing with change of state here. To change the state of a substance from solid to liquid without a change in temperature. I repeat that again, quantity of heat required to change the state of a substance from solid to liquid without a change in temperature. Now, if we have to now look at just a unit out of the entire mass of the substance in question, that takes us to specific latent heat of fusion. And we define specific latent heat of fusion as that quantity of heat that is required to change a unit mass of solid substance, to change a unit mass of solid substance at its melting point to its liquid form without a change in temperature. We denote this specific latent heat of fusion by letter L subscript I. When we talk about solid going to fusion, most times we take water as a case study. I believe you know that water can exist in three different states. We may have water in solid state, and that is ice. We have it also in liquid state, that is our normal water. And we have it also in gaseous state, that is our in form of our vapor or steam, as the case may be. Now, and we have latent heat of vaporization. We talk more about latent heat of vaporization. Let's quickly look at an example under latent heat of fusion. The question reads, what quantity of heat will be necessary to change 2 kg mass of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to water at 10 degrees Celsius? We are given the specific latent heat of ice, L subscript ice, to be 3.36 × 10⁵ joule per kilogram. As well, we are given the specific heat capacity of water to be 4200 joule per kilogram per Kelvin. Now, we can see the solution here. These are just the extraction from the question. We are given the mass of the ice to be 2 kg. The initial temperature of the ice is 0 degrees Celsius. This is the temperature we want the ice to attain after application of heat. This is the specific latent heat of our latent heat of fusion, which is that of ice, and we are having specific heat capacity of water also giving us 4200 joules. We have to find quantity total heat that we melt this ice to water at 10 degrees Celsius. Take note of that. Total heat in question is heat that is actually going to melt the ice to water, because it is until the ice first become water at 0 degrees Celsius. That is when the effect of temperature, effect of heat can actually be feasible. So heat that we melt the ice and heat that we raise the temperature of the water formed from melting of the ice to 10 degrees Celsius. That is this one. So if we substitute that, our mass in question is 2. Don't forget, it's the same ice that has turned to water. So we are dealing with the same mass here. So the mass is 2. The specific latent heat of fusion is given as 3.36 × 10⁵. The same mass, we have it as 2. Specific capacity of water, that is C subscript W. Take note of that. That's 4200. The temperature we want to raise the water to, minus the initial temperature of the water, that is 10 minus 0. And then if you multiply everything together, you are going to get our total heat to be equals to 7.56 times 10 to the 5 joule per joule. 7.56 times 10 to the 5 joule. Take note of that. Having said that, let's quickly look at experimental determination of specific heat of fission of ice. How to determine the experimental and the specific latent heat of fission of ice by experiment. Now, the procedures needed include the mass in question, the mass of the ice, the calorimeter, the stirrer, which we first weigh. When nothing is inside, we weigh the calorimeter alongside with the stirrer, and then we re-weigh it when it is about half full of water that is warm to about 5 degrees Celsius above room temperature. Now, the exact temperature is read and recorded. Take note of that. I'm talking about the procedure this time around. Some small ice blocks are dried with blotting paper and then added to the water in the calorimeter. The mixture is gently stirred continuously. Take note of that. And each piece of ice is allowed to melt completely before another one is added. Take note of that. When the temperature of the mixture is about 5 degrees Celsius below room temperature, the exact temperature is read again with our thermometer. And then the calorimeter with the contents is reweighed to find the mass of the ice that we have added. Take note of that. And then the specific latent heat of our fission of ice can then be determined. From what that we have mentioned so far, the following deductions can actually be made. The mass of calorimeter and our stirrer, if it is our M1, and the mass of calorimeter stirrer alongside with water being M2, from there we can determine the mass of water in question. That will just be subtracting M1 from M2 to get the mass of water. And then our mass of calorimeter, water, and stirrer and ice, that will be M3. If we want to get the mass of the ice that we have actually even utilized, that will just be M3 minus M2. Initial temperature of water, we take note of that. That will be our theta 1. And final temperature of the mixture, after we have dropped our ice even inside the calorimeter, and then we take that temperature also. And then the specific capacity of calorimeter. Don't forget, you have said that one before, that except otherwise stated, the thermal capacity of our container, which is the calorimeter here, is also counting, except otherwise stated that we should neglect it. Take note of that. And then we can come up to say that heat that is lost by the calorimeter and the water, we also become heat that is gained by the ice. Take note of that. When the ice gained heat, what first happened to it is that it melts to liquid, and then the temperature will now count on the water formed. Take note of that. The following precautions are to be noted. Make sure that the ice that is to be used must be a dry form of ice. That is the essence of asking us to dry it with blotting paper. It must not really be a wet ice. And likewise, the ice in question must be added in small quantity. Take note of that. And also, the mixture formed must be stirred gently and continuously. And we must ensure that the temperature attained by the mixture must be about the same amount below room temperature as the initial temperature that we have above room temperature. Take note of that. If the temperature we maintain above room temperature at the initial point is 10 degrees Celsius, we must see to it that the final temperature attained by the mixture below room temperature must also be 10 degrees Celsius and vice versa. And we must also ensure that the calorimeter is large. Now, having said that, let's quickly look at the expansion and contraction on fission. What will be the effect of expansion and contraction on fission? Now, we know that water naturally will expand on freezing to ice. Whenever we are freezing water to ice, expansion takes place. And as a result of this expansion, we notice that a glass bottle that is containing water normally cracks whenever it is put inside our water, our freezer, as a result of its expansion. And likewise also, even though ice is less dense than water, and it will float. So even though we know that ice is less than water, as a result of that, it floats on water with about 9/10 of its volume submerged in water. And we know also that whenever we are melting ice, contraction takes place. When we are freezing water, expansion takes place. But when we are melting ice, contraction takes place. Take note of that. Let's quickly look at effect of pressure and impurities on freezing point. You have it here. Effect of pressure and impurities on freezing point. Naturally, whenever pressure increases, the melting point of ice is always lowered, or the freezing point of water. Whenever we increase pressure, the effect on the melting point of ice is that it reduces or decreases the melting point of ice. An increase in pressure, and decrease in pressure automatically will bring about decrease in pressure brings about increase in the melting point of ice. Take note of this. Unfortunately, this is a reverse. There is a reverse case whenever we are dealing with amorphous substance. Don't forget, ice is a crystalline substance. If you are dealing with amorphous substance, we have the case reversed. Take note of that. We have effects to this pressure effect on on freezing point, and that is the concept of regulation. When we say regulation is just talking about a phenomenon or process that occurs whenever our ice melts when subjected to high pressure. As high pressure lowers the melting point, but the melted ice refreezes when pressure is removed. We have this case when our copper wire passes right through the ice block, and then it appears as if this will split the ice block into two. But layer above the ice block automatically refreezes again. And then even when the copper wire is already at the bottom part of the world of the ice, we still see the ice being together as just one. And likewise, also impurities, we also lower the melting point of a pure solid. Take note of that. Whenever we add impurity to pure solid, it lowers the melting point of that solid. And we have this as a reason why when we add salt to ice, most times winter period. So what they normally do to a kind of melt some of these ice pebbles that fall from space during this winter time, majorly in cold area, is they try to spread salt on the what, on the road where all this ice are falling. You understand? And so as a result of that, this salt is just acting as an impurity. And the only essence of adding this salt is just to help us lower the melting point of the ice in question. And we have also applications of pressure and impurities. The applications include in temperate region, I think I've made mention of that, we see salt being added to our sea so that it will not freeze. Even when it is covered with ice, the layer below is automatically what is maintained. And that is why aquatic animal can survive in this kind of area. And likewise, I mentioned that one also, that we throw stone and salt on the road full of ice as a result of in order to lower the melting point or the freezing point of the ice in question. Let's quickly talk about our vaporization. Now, vaporization, unlike our fission, is a process in which a substance changes from liquid now to gaseous state at a definite temperature. Take note of that. At a particular temperature, which we see later as saturation temperature, then process of changing a substance from that liquid to vapor at that definite temperature is what we call vaporization. And likewise, you can talk about circular tenth of vaporization also. Just the same way we mentioned circular tenth of fusion. Circular tenth of vaporization can actually be defined as that quantity of heat that is required to change a unit mass of a substance from its liquid at the boiling point. The case of fusion, we mentioned at its melting point, but in the case of vaporization, at its boiling point to vapor or gas without any change in temperature. And we also measure it in joule per kilogram. Just the same way we measure circular tenth of fusion. Circular tenth of vaporization is also measured in joule per kilogram. Take note of that. And let's look at an example. It says, calculate the amount of thermal energy required to change 3 grams of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to steam at 100 degrees Celsius. We are given circular tenth heat of ice and that of steam to be 336 joule per gram and 2260 joule per gram respectively. And likewise, circuit capacity of water to be 4.2 joule per gram per Kelvin. And we have our extracted data here, mass of ice, initial temperature, final temperature, circular tenth heat of fusion being given as 336 joule per gram, and circular tenth heat of vaporization being given as 2260 joule per gram. B, specific heat capacity of water, 4.2 joule per gram per Kelvin. We have to find the total heat that will help us to melt ice to steam. That is, we want to change the strength of that ice first to water and then from that water to steam. So that is why we have it here. Heat to melt ice plus heat to raise the temperature of the water formed and plus heat to change the water back to what? To vapor. That is this one. And if we substitute all the given values, mass of ice, 3, circular tenth heat of ice. Circular tenth heat of ice. Circular tenth heat of ice, that is 336 plus mass of water, the same ice turned to water, we still have it to be 3 times specific heat capacity of water 4.2, final temperature 100 minus initial temperature 0 plus mass of steam, which is still the same thing as mass of ice. It is the same ice that is changing its state. It is still 3 grams multiplied by circular tenth heat of vaporization 2260. And if we multiply everything together, this one will give us 1008, this one will produce 1260, and the last one will give us 6780. If we add everything together, we are going to have 9048 joule per kilogram. 9048 joule, that is the unit of quantity of heat. Having said this, we are actually going to end our class here today. When we meet in our next class, we'll be considering a concept that I call effect of law of cooling, and as stated by our emeritus in person of Sir Isaac Newton. And then we also consider what evaporation and rate of evaporation, factors affecting rate of evaporation. Until then, happy listening.